Well, hey guys, in today's video, I'm gonna be sharing with you 10 tips for skincare in your 20s. You all really seem to enjoy my video on skincare in your 30s, so if you are approaching your 30s or in your 30s, make sure you check that out. If you missed it, I'll list it down below. In your 20s, skincare should focus on prevention and maintenance. Prevention of aging due to things that we're exposed to, ultraviolet radiation, pollution, environmental stressors, heat, UV, etc. And by maintenance, I mean maintaining what you have. The number one thing that matters the most at all ages, but especially in your 20s, I mean, it's the one thing that you can do that will make the biggest difference. That is wearing sunscreen and protecting your skin from the sun. This is so important. The vast majority of external aging is due to exposure to ultraviolet radiation. It's not due to lack of using some jazzy serum or layering 90 different things on your face every day or patting your face with some kind of ice cold roller or poking needles into your skin. No, it's protecting your skin from ultraviolet radiation. Ultraviolet radiation from the sun upregulates matrix metallic proteinases in the deeper layers of the skin that chew up the collagen there. So wearing sunscreen and protecting your skin from the sun is the best thing that you can do at any age. And so if you're not doing it in your 20s, get on that now. But of course, sunscreen alone is not enough. I also heavily encourage the use of sun protective clothing, things like broad-brimmed hats, long sleeves, and not staying out too long in the sun. These are things that will really add up over your lifetime and reduce the visible signs of photoaging. Sun protection has to be done all year too. It's not just a summer thing or a sunny day thing. Incidental UV is around all of the time, and cumulatively over our lifetime, that adds up in the manifestations of the visible signs of photoaging, things like wrinkles, mottled pigmentation, and sagging skin. So even if it's cloudy out, not particularly sunny, or the UV index is low, that's not an excuse not to protect your skin from the sun. It still matters. We're also learning that we're exposed indoors to light sources that might also be aging our skin. Now the data on that is still in its infancy, but it's something to be aware of moving forward, and yet another reason why you should protect your skin from the sun every day with sunscreen. Number two is washing your face. This is really important and actually very nuanced. Cleansing the skin of the face is really important to do on a daily basis because if you think about it, the skin on our face and our neck as well, this is some of the most exposed real estate on our body to environmental stressors, things like pollution and environmental allergens. Another reason why cleansing at the end of the day is really important is that you need to remove sunscreen, you need to remove makeup and cosmetics from throughout the day. If those things stay on your skin, it's just more likely to cause damage throughout the night. When we sleep at night, our skin actually goes to work repairing some of the damage from throughout the day. If you still have garbage on your face in the form of pollutants, allergens, etc., it's just more work for your skin to do at night. It's more of a distraction, and it will continue to promote the formation of those free radicals that can age your skin. And if you have a underlying skin condition like acne or eczema, these things left on the skin can aggravate those conditions as well. But it's really easy to go overboard with cleansing. Using a cleanser that is too harsh or cleansing too frequently can strip your skin of its natural lipids and disrupt what's called the acid mantle of the skin barrier, and therefore make you predisposed to dry skin and irritation. So the key is figuring out a frequency of cleansing your skin that works for you. Some people with oily skin do just fine cleansing their skin twice a day. They like to wash their face in the morning to remove some sebum from the surface of the skin that makes them look shiny, and they never have issues with dryness. Other people, like myself, if I do that, my skin gets too dry. And you may find that once you get into your 30s and 40s, you have to back down on the frequency. But in your 20s, you may be one of those oily people who really gets along well with cleansing twice a day. And I'm not here to tell you that you need to stop that if that's working for you. But pay attention to the cleanser that you're using. Some cleansers can be very harsh and strip the skin. You really want to pay attention that your cleanser is not leaving your skin feeling squeaky clean. That is basically a sign of a stripped skin barrier that can lead to a lot of dryness and irritation. Recently, I did a video on how your skincare habits affect your microbiome, and over cleansing or using cleansers that are too harsh for the skin barrier can disrupt the microbiome of your skin as well. So that's yet another reason to really figure out what's going to work best for you. It is very individualized, but too much is not a good thing, and ditching your cleanser altogether is also not a good thing. So strike a balance that works for you, but make sure you have some degree of cleansing on a daily basis. Number three, exfoliation. Okay, I'm here to tell you that there's a chance you can ignore the need to exfoliate. This is everywhere in beauty ads and whatnot, that you need to be exfoliating, that you need to be exfoliating. And I honestly think it gives a lot of people in their 20s a lot of anxiety to hear this, because they don't know how, they don't know where to start, they don't know which ones. There are a lot of different exfoliants out there. There's chemical, there's mechanical. I have videos on all of these, but if you were in your 20s, there's a good chance you don't really need to focus on exfoliating. Certain people will benefit from it with certain skin conditions. People with acne, at the root of that disease, there's a problem with exfoliating the pore that leads to plugged up pores and flares of the acne. And those people benefit from consistent use of maybe salicylic acid, a chemical exfoliant that focuses in those oily surfaces in the pores and exfoliates the pores and helps the acne. People with a dry skin condition called keratosis pilaris, they have trouble exfoliating dry skin off the surface of their skin. It stays around the pore, and they get these little dry red bumps. And so they actually benefit from consistent use of an alpha hydroxy acid moisturizer to soften that dry stuff and help it exfoliate. So some people do benefit from using an exfoliant, but not everybody needs to be using one. So if you don't have these conditions, don't worry about the exfoliating. You exfoliate to a certain extent when you cleanse the skin. You're helping to remove some of the, you know, encourage the sloughing of those skin cells naturally as they're being shed. And so, you know, in my opinion, people in their 20s, unless you have one of these skin conditions, there's no reason to, you know, worry about this exfoliating thing. So just ignore all of the marketing around, we all need to be exfoliating. Like, okay, no, it's not a one size fits all approach. So I talked about sunscreen and cleansers, but the third thing that is important in everyone's skincare routine, at least in my opinion, is a moisturizer. Moisturizers are really important to apply to the skin after cleansing because they help aid in skin barrier recovery and they help reduce what's called transepidermal water loss that ultimately leads to dryness. Moisturizers are also really important in that they help restoring the acid mantle and facilitating an overall healthier skin microbiome. And moisturizer is also a really helpful thing for people who have an underlying skin condition like eczema or acne or rosacea, because a lot of these diseases have an underlying component to them that has to do with an impaired skin barrier. And moisturizers really kind of step in that setting. Not only that, these conditions are often treated with medications whose side effects include dryness, irritation, burning, and stinging. And we know that using a moisturizer along with these medications reduces those side effects and ultimately yields better results in terms of reduction of the burden of disease. So using a moisturizer throughout your lifetime can really benefit your skin quite a bit. Those are the basics of skincare. Moving on to number five, what about incorporating an antioxidant serum in your 20s? Specifically, what about vitamin C serum? Vitamin C, if you're not familiar, also goes by the name L-ascorbic acid. It is an antioxidant which, when applied topically to the skin, has been shown in small studies to improve collagen production, to reduce the burden of damage due to ultraviolet radiation exposure, to reduce free radical production. There's some thought that incorporating a vitamin C serum into your skincare routine might help in preventing some of the visible signs of photoaging related to ultraviolet radiation exposure, as well as the free radical damage that occurs from exposure to other environmental insults like pollution. And here's the thing though, vitamin C or L-ascorbic acid, it has many limitations. It's difficult to get it into the skin and it is not very stable. It oxidizes very readily. Its uptake into the skin is very dependent on its pH. So it's a very nuanced and finicky ingredient. In my opinion, using a vitamin C serum is absolutely not necessary in your 20s or 30s or 40s or 50s. It's a matter of personal consumer preference. And the reason I say this is because while we have some small studies showing benefit with using vitamin C serum, things like improvement of hyperpigmentation and boosting up collagen production, we do not have studies that actually show that using a vitamin C serum reduces the signs of photoaging ultimately. So for example, we don't have studies of people in their 20s who start using a vitamin C serum versus people in their 20s who don't use vitamin C serum and then let them age, you know, throughout their lifetime and look at them in their 30s and 40s and 50s side by side and, you know, compare the extent of photoaging. We don't really have studies like that. So to say that these are necessary to prevent photoaging, it's really not substantiated. Whether or not you use it, it's a matter of personal preference. You can make the argument that it would be beneficial to introduce it in your 20s, but in my opinion, we don't have the data to say that it makes a difference long-term if people use it in their 20s and continue to use it. So it's a matter of personal preference. Number six, though, is one that we do have a lot of data on as far as efficacy and reducing the burden of sun damage, photoaging, and actually helping your skin deal with ultraviolet radiation better. And that is using a retinol or topical vitamin A. Now, the topical vitamin A form that we have the most data on for anti-aging benefit is going to be retinoic acid, aka tretinoin. Why? Because it's been around the longest. So because it's been around so long, we have enough time with it to see these anti-aging benefits. At least here in the States, tretinoin, retinoic acid, is only available by prescription. But we do have studies that suggest that using a retinol or retinaldehyde, something you can buy over the counter, also has anti-aging benefits. It just takes longer to start working. So that is another option. I will list down below some retinols that I recommend. If you have acne, however, an over-the-counter retinol product that is FDA approved for the treatment of acne is adapalene. So that's an option. You can get some of the acne control benefits of using a topical vitamin A over-the-counter. And we also have some studies showing that adapalene, aka Differin, has some of the same anti-aging benefits as retinoic acid, aka tretinoin. We don't have nearly as many, that's for sure, but we have a few that show some improvement in some of the visible signs of photoaging with using adapalene. So that's another option. You know, as a side note, I get a lot of questions from people, I think mostly a lot of people in their 20s and 30s, asking me how to go about convincing your doctor to prescribe tretinoin to you for anti-aging. Here's the thing, you guys. I totally understand why your doctor might have reservations about doing this because it's a prescription, so they have to assume responsibility for the outcome. If you develop a problem with it, too much irritation or whatnot, it's on them to manage that. And they may not have the ability to follow up with you in their schedule as part of how their clinic runs. So I totally get why many doctors might not want to prescribe it for cosmetic reasons, especially in young people, because they may not have the ability to follow up with you. And so if you develop an adverse reaction or whatever, you know, it's on them. They have a duty to follow up with you and whatnot. And so they may not be able to accommodate that in their schedule. It's not that they're, you know, blowing you off or being lazy or anything like that. It's simply the nature of how these things work. We have to assume a level of responsibility for the medications that we prescribe. So I totally understand why a lot of physicians may be like, no, I'm not prescribing that, because, you know, they're responsible for it. So don't worry too much about getting retinoic acid or getting tretinoin, like you have to have it. But if you do want to incorporate topical vitamin A, do know that using a retinol over the counter, at least using it consistently and long term, can offer the same advantages of using tretinoin. It just won't happen as rapidly as using tretinoin. All right, so those are products, but honestly, if you've watched any number of my videos right now, you should know and you should understand that skincare products, I mean, they only go so far. And the biggest game changer in giving ultimate results is going to be sunscreen and sun protection. But the other thing that matters 10 times more is your lifestyle. Specifically, number seven is your diet. Oh my gosh, this makes a huge difference. I mean, you can be You can be tapping your skin and ice crystalling it to death, and if you have a crappy diet, you know, it doesn't matter. People who eat fruits and vegetables have a better ability to handle the damaging effects of ultraviolet radiation in the skin. They have a elevated minimal erythematous dose. And basically what that means is the minimal amount, it takes more sun to damage their skin than somebody who doesn't eat like that, doesn't eat fruits and vegetables. Because of the carotenoids and things like that, they help your skin function better. So make sure that you're getting the recommended servings of fruits and vegetables. Don't fear fruits and vegetables as like being sugar rich. Find those that you like and enjoy eating and try and get a variety. That's really helpful. Make sure that you incorporate healthy fats into your diet, things like nuts, seeds, avocado. These help with the lipid barrier and keeping your skin healthy and functioning well. Stay away from the sugary processed foods. Sugary processed foods have a high glycemic load and a high glycemic index, and this translates into an increase in the formation of advanced glycation end products in the skin. What the heck is that? Think of it as like chewing gum on your collagen fibers and things like that, basically clumping up due to sugar and these glycation end products, they're called. And that contributes to wrinkle formation, and it also contributes to darkening of the skin with age that has nothing to do with pigment. It's just a darkening of the skin related to glycation in the deeper layers of the skin. So don't eat, I'm not gonna tell you not to eat cookies or cake or candy or sweets that you enjoy, absolutely, but don't like subsist off of that. Eat a balanced diet and try and, you know, not gravitate towards sugary processed foods or convenience foods, things that come out of a window are generally not, you know, the best for us to subsist off of. Sure, they're fine once in a while, but try and keep that in check. Make sure that you are eating healthy foods, ideally cooked at home. That often can be the best bet. That actually will show up on your skin for sure. If you have acne, eating sugary foods, it can spike your insulin levels. That insulin-like growth factor promotes oil production and flares of the acne. The other thing that matters a lot is exercise. No, you don't have to be an athlete. No, you don't have to be running marathons every day. But make sure that you get some cardiovascular exercise a few times a week at least, and try and move more. It really makes a difference in the health of your skin and your skin's ability to handle the free radical damage. It ultimately reduces total body inflammation levels, which translate to better skin health. It improves circulation, which lends itself to more radiant skin. And if you have acne or any other inflammatory skin condition, the reduction in inflammation that comes with exercise or consistent exercise will help those conditions ultimately. If you're in your 20s, listen up. I talk about this all the time, but I feel like in your 20s, there's such a pressure to skip this, and that is your sleep. Getting 8 hours of sleep is probably one of the best things that you can start doing if you're not already for your skin long term. As I alluded to earlier in this video, at nighttime when we sleep, and I say at nighttime because that's when most people sleep, but if you have to sleep during the daytime because of your work schedule, you know, make sure you get the 8 hours is what I'm getting at. But when we sleep, there are certain hormones that are released that impact the ability of the skin to regenerate, and really a lot of focus happens on healing the skin and recovering the skin, dealing with free radical damage. If you don't sleep adequately, you don't give your skin enough time to do that properly. And if you're not sleeping properly, your body's going to release more stress hormones that are going to further impair your skin function, and you know, that's not gonna be a good thing. Sleep is really important. You know, in my 20s, it was all the rage for you to subsist on very little sleep. And if I could go back in time and tell myself, my younger self, something, it would be like, no, this is important. Even though people are not stressing it, it is very important. And I wish I had done it sooner, because the other reason is if you form poor sleep habits that young in your 20s or, you know, late teens or whatever, it's going to be harder to break when you get wiser. Trust me, from experience, it's hard to rectify bad sleep habits. I know this firsthand because I've been working on it myself for many years now. All right, so we talked about exercise, we talked about sleep, and we talked about diet. Last but not least, number 10, and no beauty editor is going to tell you guys this, no you know, magazine or infomercial or whatever is gonna tell you this. But I know firsthand as a dermatologist that this makes a difference. Minimize the number of products that you use. People think they have to be using all of this stuff in order to have healthy, good-looking skin and to protect their skin. And that's the opposite of true. The fewer things that you put on your skin, the better. Focus on cleanser, moisturizer, sunscreen, and you know, do the best you can with staying consistent on those three things. Staying consistent with cleanser, moisturizer, and sunscreen, that's perfect. Once you dial that in, that's all you really, really need to be doing to keep your skin healthy. Beyond that, it's going to be your lifestyle factors. Products really, you know, yes, they can improve some of the visible signs of photo aging, and you know, they can help make your skin transiently look a little bit better, a little more glowy, but that's transient. The lifestyle things are really what are gonna carry you long term, and the fewer things you put on your skin, the better.
The more products we come across, the more problems we see. Yeah, more products, more problems.
And I know this firsthand as a dermatologist, because if I prescribe a patient one cream, the likelihood of them using that one cream consistently is about here. If I prescribe the patient two creams, the likelihood of them using the creams consistently drops to about here. I'm not making this up. Why do you think pharmaceutical companies have combination creams? That's why there is EpiDuo, adapalene plus benzoyl peroxide. You can use each of those ingredients on their own, but your compliance will go down tremendously. It's just the nature of it. I'm not making this up. There's actual data behind it showing that the more topicals, the less likely people are to stick with it. It's not sustainable. It's not sustainable. Too many things and you forget, or you're in a hurry. Fewer products, better. It improves your compliance, reduces the risk that problems will arise, and honestly is ultimately better for your wallet as well and your counter space. Yeah, fewer products, better. More products, more problems. All right, guys, those are my top 10 tips for skincare in your 20s. Enjoy your 20s. It was a very stressful time for me, but it was also a very fun time. So if you like this video, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and as always, don't forget, sunscreen and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.